My name is Liz. I'm on the brand team with Magic. Welcome to Drive to Work. So some exciting things are going to happen this time around with Drive to Work. Number one, it's live, which is sweet. Number two is that the mailbag with Matt is happening right here, right now. Those are your mail pieces. Write down your questions, pass them all the way to your right, to the lovely Leah and the bodacious Brian. They will take those, and they will be handing them off later to Matt Cavotta, who will read your questions live if he deems them worthy. So, with that being said, if you don't have a pen, please share with your neighbor. Use some hand sanitizer later. Nobody wants the Pax Pox. What? Sorry. All right, without further ado, I'm going to introduce the stars of our Drive to Work. We have Mark Rosewater, head designer of Magic the Gathering. And his carpool mate, is Matt Cavotta, senior creative art director from Magic. So let's get going.
Beep beep.
I love your new car. It's very roomy.
Okay, I'm pulling up the driveway. We all know what that means. It's another time for
Drive to Work.
That doesn't happen often, so. So we've dubbed this episode Live to Work because for the first time ever, we're not in a moving vehicle, but we're trying to create the illusion.
The illusion.
So I checked ahead of time. Normally it takes about 28 to 30 minutes to get to work, but there are some Eldrazi on the 405, so.
As if it wasn't bad enough already.
So it's going to be extra extended. It looks like it's going to take us about an hour to get to work. So we've broken up today into two parts. So we're going to start by talking about Zendikar.
Sweet.
We're doing battle for Zendikar. And so it's time to talk about the original Zendikar. So you need a ride to work again.
Oh, absolutely.
In fact, that's why you've been my number one guest, is your need to get to work.
My car is a clunker. It's a jalopy. Problems all the time.
Okay, so I thought today we'd start by talking about the normal story I tell about Zendikar, but then tell some stories you haven't heard. So the normal story, whenever we talk about Zendikar, is I wanted to do a land set. No one thought it was a good idea, except for Mike Turing thought it was a good idea. But other, me and Mike Turing, no one thought it was a good idea. But Bill Rose said, well, okay, I'll give you a couple months to try, but if you can't prove it, we're not going to do it. And then we did it. Zendikar came out, big hit. We're not coming back to Zendikar. But the stories we haven't told are in between those time periods. So what happened was, Bill said to me I had 3 months to prove my idea. So pretty much I had this idea of land mechanics. I thought there was a lot of space. And I said, okay, well, let's see if we can make that work. So my design team was Doug Beyer, Ken Nagel, Graham Hopkins, and Matt Place was our developer. And so I said to them, okay, we have 3 months to prove we can do this. Let's start making land mechanics.
How did that work out?
Well, it went really badly for the first 2 months. We made like 40 mechanics and like we tried a mechanic and it was really, really bad. And so we tried another mechanic and that was unfun. And we tried another mechanic and
how often is that the case? That it's like swing and a miss, swing and a miss?
A lot. I mean, what people don't realize is one of our jokes is that we play a lot of bad magic so the audience can play good magic. So we tried all sorts of different things. Like one of the things we tried was
all chimney imp.
We tried using land as a resource. So the idea was, if you guys remember Goblin Rock Sled, the idea that you can't play it unless you, you can't play it if you play the land. It requires your land drop for the turn as a cost. And that turns out to be really unfun. Because what happened was we found the playtesting, people would just play the cards that required it, not get their lands, and then their opponent would kill it, and then they would have no lands, and they would die, and that was not fun. So we experimented, and one of the things that I always tell about, like, the end story, we're very successful, but I was really actually worried, like, we went through, like, 40 mechanics. So one of the things I was concerned about was, like, will this actually work? I mean, I went in with the theory of, while there seems like there's a lot of potential here, I'm sure we could find it. And I told everybody it would work. So when I say to everybody, like, oh, it'll work, trust me, and they're like, okay, we'll give you 3 months, make it happen, and then it's not working, I was actually really nervous.
Was that the most doubt you've had about an idea that you pushed early on?
Oh, no.
No?
Oh, no. I've had ideas that haven't worked. This one actually eventually did pan out.
But of the ones that have panned out, was that the The one that you sweated the most?
Maybe. Well, I put a lot on the line because I'm like, no, this will work, this will work. Like, no one believed it. So, like, I literally...
I was one of those people.
Yes. Like, whenever I tell the story now, because now we're going to battle for Zendikar, people always say, oh, yeah, I didn't think that would work. Like, Elaine Chase is our brand manager, and I was talking about it. She goes, oh, yeah, I really didn't think that was going to work. So what happened was we eventually made landfall. We went, we burned through a lot of mechanics to get to landfall, but eventually we went to landfall. When we made landfall, I breathed a sigh of relief. I said, oh, this is actually fun. We can make this. And then Doug Beyer was the creative member of our team. So Doug had to figure out how, you know, what world was it supposed to be?
Right.
So did I ever tell you what world I wanted it to be?
No.
I don't think I've ever told people this. So I knew we'd
this
have a lot of...
This was Chimney Imp world?
Not Chimney Imp world. So I knew we had a lot of land cards, meaning we'd just see a lot of illustrations of lands. And I'm like, well, how do we make it dynamic? Because, you know, there's just a lot of cards with land on them. So my idea was weather world. Where it was just a world where the weather had gone crazy, and like this land has a tornado on it, and this one has a tidal wave on it, and that was my idea.
That's not that far from where it actually landed.
Kind of. Well, I mean, but I think my big thing was that visually the land would be like under some. You see different kind of iconic duresses. So like you'd see the tsunami, you'd see the earthquake, you would see the I don't know what mudslide, whatever the happens in what the world.
I don't know. I think all of those happen in Zendikar. That's you know possible. What? Your dream came true.
So what happened was Doug was the one that came up with the idea of Adventure World.
I think that turned out to be a wonderful, flavorful icing to put over the land cake.
No, I'm sorry. I can't look at you.
Dude,
okay.
Watch out for that pothole.
Okay.
It turned out to be a wonderful way to pull together the the bones of Land Matters World with a fantastical flavor that cares about a land that is dangerous and precarious and all that good stuff that Zendikar has probably more than any of our other worlds.
Yeah, no. So what we did was we made we had landfall, we had a bunch of land mechanics, we had the comes and play lands, we had a bunch of land things. Then we knew we needed a kicker because we had so much mana. We're like, well, we need a mechanic where you can spend a lot of mana. And then that's when we went to the creative team and said, okay, it's got landfall, it's got land matters, it's got kicker. What do you got for us? And then Doug came back with Adventure World. And then from there, we made what I at a time called Traps, Maps, and Chaps, which was Traps, Quests, and the Allies.
You know, what is interesting about that that bit of the story is that some of that... Adventure World development happened after we were initially concepting the world, because none of that was provided to us.
When I actually drive, I watch the road. By the way, some people are like, well, "He's a dangerous driver. He's watching man talk." So I actually watch the road. So.
None of that Adventure World layer was provided to us when we were doing the concepting for the world. At that time, we were still. We were still banking on your land matters world.
They don't know that. So Matt actually wasn't working at the company at the time, but you were brought in for the world building team.
Yes, for the.
So explain what the world building team is. People that don't know what a world building team is.
For each of our sets, we bring in a team of artists that work on the cards. Some of which might be new to the scene. In fact, with Zendikar, Vincent Prost was brought in as part of the. Our art concepting team, and he had never done any magic before, but Jeremy felt like he had his style had a particular handle on the sort of chaotic and gritty nature that Zendikar needs. So there were three artists working with Richard Witters on this one, myself, Vincent, and something funny?
I don't ever look at him, but we're actually doing the show with him.
And Mark Tadine. Those three artists work with the in-house creatives to help flesh out the ideas that they have, drawing picture after picture after picture, searching for the answers, and quite a bit falls on the cutting room floor. But as things start to take root, they stay up on the wall, and those ideas end up germinating into more ideas, and that's basically how it works.
So there's a good story that I tell about the origins of the Hedrons. So Mark Tadine, obviously, has been drawing magic from the early days, and he loves geometric shapes. I mean, loves geometric shapes. And so when he was sketching, because what happens is they come in, We give them an overview of kind of what is going on, and the artists are kind of let free to just make things that they're inspired by. And so he drew this landscape with these hedrons in it. I don't, because he likes hedrons. I don't know what inspired it.
It was, well, Mark was, Mark had another previous engagement that he had agreed to. So he came in just a couple hours a day. He would breeze in, grind out drawings. He's prolific when he was in the building. And then he would disappear again. And one day he came in, did a drawing that had this wonderful, you know, triangular-shaped thing jammed into the land, and then he disappeared again. And Vincent and I were like, that's the thing. Like, I started drawing that into everything.
Yes.
It got a little comical at one point. We started baking it into, like, people's heads and all over the place. But we reeled that back to...
Also, what people don't realize that the concept thing is, like, you guys see the finished product. What they do in the concept, that we have a wall, we put stuff up on the wall, and there's quite crazy ideas. And some of the crazy ideas stick, but a lot of times it's like, what if their heads were hedrons? Like, okay, maybe not.
It was like you said earlier, we draw bad magic, so you guys don't have to see it.
So one of the things that happened, but meanwhile, on my side of the wall, where you guys were concepting, is, so originally the plan was, we were going to go to Zendikar, we were going to have a small set in Zendikar, and the last large set, we're going to have a large set of the third set, wasn't at all going to be in Zendikar, because there was no faith that I could make this work for a whole block. So we were going to go someplace else. That was the plan. But the creative team wasn't staffed up to do a second world. And so they were freaking out. They're like, we can't build a second world. I mean, now we've staffed up. And the reason we can do it now is the team's much, much bigger than it used to be. So they were all worried. So they're like, how can we not leave Zendikar? And so they were trying to figure out what was going on. Eventually, they got this neat idea that things were trapped inside. The reason the land was so crazy was there was something trapped inside it. And somehow, like, the hedron craziness and the Eldrazi's kind of like
chocolate,
came together. Yeah.
Peanut butter.
And then all of a sudden the hedrons became like the prison, right?
Yes.
Because that happened late. That was not... All we knew was there were lots of hedrons and we later decided the Eldrazi were there. And then like, I think late on, like, oh, what if the hedrons and the Eldrazi were all tied together? So...
We're pretty good at that. We're pretty good at taking bits of the creative that might seem unrelated and... making Reese's cups out of them.
So when you guys designed it, do we have traps or allies or was any of that stuff there yet?
No.
Okay.
No. That's why we latched onto the hedrons so much. We're like, we have nothing.
Yeah, so what happened was Doug came back, said we're going to do the creative. And the cool thing was once they went around the company saying it's adventure world, then it was, oh, yeah, that could work. It's like, we're doing land world. That's not going to work. And I kept changing the name. Like, I was calling it Lanzapalooza, and then for a while I was calling it The Money Set. That was the nickname for the set for a while. It's The Money Set. You want The Money Set? And they're like, oh, okay, sure. But then we got Adventure World, and they really liked Adventure World, so.
Adventure World's fun. It's fun to, it was fun to illustrate, absolutely. It's fun to play. It's fun to write flavor text for. Adventure World was something that, from a creative person perspective, had meat to chew on and things to explore. Land world, not so much.
It's a starting off point. Yeah, it's a jumping
off point. It's a jumping off point.
The plan was never like magic land set. That was never like, you know, that was not, we were going to put creative onto it. That was always the plan. So a lot of things, this is what we call a bottoms up set, meaning we started with a mechanic idea and then we added our own flavors and went along.
Nowadays, ever considered a land, no land?
People all the time ask you for
floating,
no land.
Floating world? No?
No. Yeah, I don't know if not...
You make a good four or five cards out of that.
The thing people ask all the time is, could we do a no-land set or an all-land set, both of which are horrible, horrible ideas.
So we explored those, right?
Yes. So the other thing about Zendikar, I try to think back, so I'm trying to tell the stories you guys haven't heard, because I've told a lot of the similar stories. So the other interesting thing about Zendikar was, we were trying to figure out when we were making it, which pieces made sense. So like... I think we ended up doing the traps and the quest, but we were trying all sorts of different things. Oh, so one of the things was, we have mini teams. So the way the mini team works is that you have, you get a bunch of people and you give them a quest and they go off and they design to it. So I was put on the mini team for quests. So here's what I came up with, which got rejected. But the idea was that you would have art you'd have objects in the art. And the idea was you'd have to go get three objects. So the one I made was called like, like trip to the graveyard or something. And so you had to get a zombie, you had to get a dead body, and you had to get a shovel, which was an equipment, and you had to get a necromancer, which was a cleric. And if you got all those, then you got to raise a dead body. And so like the idea was, as you got things, you would put a little counter on the picture, so that you, oh, I got the shovel, oh, I got the, you know.
It's like a little scavenger hunt. How fun.
So what happens is I come up with neat things that I think are cool, and then the artist goes, that would look horrible, no. And so that got nixed because Jeremy really didn't like the idea of one-fourth a shovel and one-fourth a necromancer. So, but I thought it was cool.
That was going to... Okay, I...
Do you remember that, the quest?
I like the idea of the little scavenger hunt, but I don't understand why that has to turn into a...
Well, the memory issues.
Ridiculous.
Like, we needed some way for you to know that, oh, I got the shovel, now I can reference it. So, I mean, we could just do it and you have the memory issues,
shovel,
but it's
counters.
A lot to remember.
Of course.
Well, we could put three different counters. I don't know. Anyway.
Whatever.
So. The other interesting thing was the allies, as you guys know them, were different. In fact, the allies changed right at the end. I don't even remember how they originally worked. The allies, we made something for allies, and it sucked, and everybody didn't like it. And then right near the end, Matt Place and I completely revamped it all, and then we modeled them after the D&D types. Remember this?
I do not.
There were fighters and clerics and wizards.
Hmm.
So the fighters were the ones that got the +1/+1 counters on them. The clerics were the one that affected everybody. And the wizards were the one that generated an effect where you counted the allies and it did that large an effect. Anyway, that was our nod to D&D, so. But,
I had no idea you did that.
So what else? So you were just there for concepting?
I was just there in the house for concepting, yes.
Did you do flavor text? Or,
I did.
Or crits? So what,
I did.
What did any...
Oh, God.
Do you remember any of the creative of Zendikar stories?
I'm on the spot. No, I don't.
Yeah, I remember there was a talk of whether or not they wanted any flavor text from the POV of the Eldrazi, and the idea was they experimented with it, but the idea was, no, the Eldrazi, like, you can't understand them, so you don't want to hear them actually talk, because then you would understand them.
That would destroy the illusion so much if they said things. That would just be
But
the,
somewhere
terrible.
In some file is, like, somebody taking an attempt on, what does the Eldrazi sound like? You know. In fact, Dave Guskin, someone who used to work with us, he made an Eldrazi sound, and so whenever we talk about the Eldrazi, we would call him over to make the Eldrazi sound. And he now has moved on, so we have nobody at Wizards to make the Eldrazi sound anymore. So.
Sad times.
Okay, so I think one of the things we need to do is we're going to pull over here, make a little stop.
Hey, I'm hungry.
I'm hungry. So we're going to make a little stop. What do you feel like?
Donuts.
Donuts, okay. Let me pull over to this drive-through donut place that conveniently is right here.
Welcome to Zendikar Matt's Donut Emporium. May I take your order, please?
Yes, I would like to have some donuts.
How many donuts would you like?
I want a chocolate one.
102.
102 donuts.
Yes.
Can I get you anything else, sir?
No. How much will that be?
Your total will be 5.
Okay, hold on.
You must give me 5. Never mind, one moment.
So anyway, donuts for everybody! Yeah. Okay, so now...
But wait, there's more.
Literally, donuts for everybody, so enjoy.
Please accept these coupons, good for a future visit to Zendikar Matt's Donut Emporium. Have a nice day.
Okay, for the second part of our drive, we're going to do a feature we call Mailbag with Matt.
Wait, don't drive off, sir. 2 more coupons.
Okay, so this is the feature we've been doing. I think we've done 2 or 3 of them so far. So the idea is, all of you have submitted questions, which Matt will now judge and read some of them, and we will answer.
I deem this one worthy.
I put the good ones in front.
This one's fun.
Okay.
So, we were talking about this earlier.
Okay.
What can you tell us about previous podcast mess-ups or mishaps that we never got to see?
Okay, so the way it works is, I have no editing capabilities whatsoever. I start... I stop, that's it. If I mess up between start and stop, I have to do it again on a different day. It's a very high-tech process. So I have messed up a number of times. The record is having to do it 4 times. That's the most I've ever done. That was all 1 week of the same podcast. Because I drive in 4 days a week. I'm home on Fridays. And the one I remember with you is when I always turn my phone off so it doesn't ring because I'm recording on my phone. But Matt's phone rings.
Yep. My phone started ringing, and it was Mark's wife. That was really weird. I was like, what is this all about?
Right, so Laura needed us to jump the car because the car didn't start, so we had to turn around. And we had done it really good. Like, we were doing really good, but I think I swear on it because I'm like, I knew we had to go back, so we couldn't keep it, so.
There was some gold on that one, dude.
There was gold. It was
lost to time.
I remember one of the things that will happen all the time is I will say something and then realize I'm not supposed to say the thing I said, and then usually it's me swearing, and if I'm close to the house, I will drive back to the house and start again. But, and by the way, one of my things is when I say I'm pulling out my driveway, I in fact must be pulling out of my driveway. I'm not like cheating it. I will actually be pulling out of my driveway. There's integrity to this podcast, so I will do that. Okay.
How about this one? What color identity is your driving style?
Today or normally? I don't know. So far on all my drive to works, I have a clean, I've never ever had any incident on any drive to work other than giving away things I'm not supposed to and then having swears. But I don't know.
We almost had that one incident.
Well, yes, for my wife. My wife almost hit us one time. So.
Actually, it was the same day that we went and jumped the car, and somehow, like 20 minutes later, like down the road, she had caught up to us, and it almost cut us off getting onto the freeway. It was crazy. So.
That one, by the way, I mean, it's one of the recordings with us. Like, you can hear
it. Yeah, you can hear
Matt starts laughing about it, because I go, that's Laura. And
what are the odds that it was her? This is so crazy. It was good. This is a bit of an extension from an earlier theme of our conversation. Can you tell us about a hilariously bad mechanic that was play-tested and will never see print?
Yes. Okay, so I made a mechanic for Tempest, the very first set I led, and the way the mechanic worked was you could choose to have one less card in your opening hand, but you could put this card in it. And so the idea was they were really weak, but you could guarantee put it in your opening hand. And that broke Magic, so don't do that. Another one I remember from Tempest was a card, or this was, I don't know if a mechanic, a single card, where when you played it, you can discard any number of cards you wanted, and for every card you discarded, you drain your opponent for 2. That took one play test to realize how stupid that was.
This one is just for you.
Oh, just for me, okay.
How is it that you've trained your nephew Josh to be so evil and powerful at such a young age?
I think it's natural gifted. I didn't do a lot of training.
Is that kid here today?
He is. Josh is right here. Say hi, Josh.
Here's a Zendikar-related question. Any chance of a land with subtype ally?
Ally land. I think when lands get animated, they get a subtype. So, I mean, it's
theoretically. It's possible.
Yeah, it's possible. Yeah. Wait a minute! Isn't Tree Trap Village an 8?
Sir, slow down. I need to tell you something. No.
Man, that donut shop guy is a little ornery.
It's almost like he's
nasty. Let's see.
Okay.
Here.
Da-da-da.
I guess this one counts more as a suggestion, but okay, I'll throw it out there anyway. I'd love to see my dueling history with my friends on planeswalkerpoints.com. Thoughts?
Dueling history? I don't know. So one of the interesting things about my job is, as a spokesperson is I get people talking to me all the time about things that I literally have zero to do with, and I get to try to answer them without having tons of knowledge. Like
actually,
now.
It didn't ask for an answer. It just asked for thoughts.
Thoughts.
So this counts.
That would be awesome if we could do that.
So,
I don't know technically that we can.
Is that in the interest of just knowing how to gloat over your pals that you've beaten down a lot?
Yeah,
because that sounds like fun.
I think there was somebody once that made a program, wasn't us, that could tell you against people you played who you done well against versus who you did poorly against, so you could gloat against people that you did well against. That was fun.
All right. When are we getting a legendary bear or bear planeswalker?
Okay, so one of the questions I get all the time is people ask me about, I want a legendary fill in the blank. So the number one request I get for legendary things is bear.
Why?
Because it is. Number two, ooze. So one of the things that I felt really bad, this is where the ball was dropped in Concert Tarkir, is when we made the clans, I had no idea that the Tarkir was so bear-focused. I just honestly didn't know. Had I known, like the Berry Punches could have been a legendary bear. That's a famous bear.
Yeah.
But anyway, what happened was I didn't figure this out until I saw the art, and by that point it was so far along, I couldn't. Like, I talked to Eric, he was the lead developer, and we talked about could we get some bear tribal in, maybe find a place for a bear, but it was too late. So I will vow this now as I drive to work. One day there shall be a legendary bear. And hopefully also legendary ooze.
Have you ever considered booster packs with more or less cards?
Well, let me talk to you about it's called the die line.
We've done that though, haven't we?
We've done booster packs with less cards.
Yeah.
Early Magic, actually, there were packs with 8 cards, there have been packs with 10 cards, there have been packs with 12 cards, there have been packs with 5 cards, I think, at Walmart.
We did the promo pack for Ugin with, I think it had just, was it 3 cards?
Oh, 8 total.
Oh, gotcha.
One of the big issues is, right now, we have 15 cards and we have the rules cards. We have 16 cards. The booster pack can't handle another card. It can't handle it, Captain. It can't take another card. So we've talked about that, but we can't actually add a 17th. That won't fit. And the one of the things is, this comes up whenever I try to change things, the cast people come to me and say, Mark, so a die line means the box has to be a certain size. You have to cut it, and the packs have to fit right in. This is what you do all the time. So, you can't just change things without causing all sorts of chaos.
Yeah, there's a whole cascading bit of chaos when you make a little tweak like that, even if it's just, you know, wafer thin.
Yeah, people always say, like, one card. You can't just add one card. Like, no, you actually can't add one card. We've maxed out the booster
As long
pack.
As we subtract one, we can add one. This one's very pointed. How tall are you?
Well, apparently close to Matt's height right now. No, I am 5'5". I'm 5'5". Five. How tall are you?
I am 6'3". Thank you.
So R&D, by the way, one of the things happened. R&D has slowly been hiring taller people. And so the average height of R&D has gone up over time. And so...
We're trying to outfit a basketball team.
Well, we're getting close. We actually... my design team, I think the pit right now, we have many, many people over 6 feet. We have numerous people over 6 feet, so... I'm the second smallest person. Do I know? There's a guy named Dave Marcy. He's 5'4". So I'm the second smallest person in R&D. And in the pit. Probably R&D.
Could you do a drive to work with Graham Stark of Friday Nights over PAX about the Friday Nights series?
Okay, so people all the time ask me if I can have so-and-so as a guest on the show. So here's the thing, people, maybe they don't believe I'm actually driving to work. But
so as awesome as I am, I'm pretty sure I wouldn't be part of this if I didn't live by Mark.
Yes. No, I'm saying your number one quality for being the guest is...
Number one.
...is your close proximity and your need to get to work.
That's true.
So here's a little trivia. For all the guests I've had on my show. So Ethan Fleischer came to my house once. He lives in Issaquah, so he lives nearby, although not near as close as you. Both my mom and my dad, on separate occasions, I was driving them to work and or the airport. Melissa DeToro actually drove to my house. She lives nowhere near my house. She drove to my house to do... normally I only drive to work, but every once in a while when I have a guest, one time with Matt, one time with Melissa, I'll do a drive from work because I get extra... because Melissa had to get back to my house, so we did an extra podcast. But I think that is it.
Yeah.
I don't think... So anyway, people ask all the time, can you have Richard Garfield on? Can you have Graham on? I'm like, if they'll come to my house, I will have almost anybody on. But they have to come to my house because I'm not making this up. This might be a screw around, but normally I'm driving to work. I'm not sitting in a studio and have sound effects or something. I'm actually driving to work. Really, people doubt me. They think like it's some scam that I'm pretending. But it's not, so.
Do you think the iterations of Jace have taken up too much of Blue's design space?
Planeswalker design space?
I guess.
I mean, one of the things we're trying to do is we started making a somebody to oversee the planeswalkers mechanically to make sure that each have a strong mechanical identity. So Liliana in the Dark Realm sort of, we feel we messed up. She's not all about swamps. She's a necromancer. And we sort of like, she kind of veered off into other black things. And what we realized is if we want to make a lot of planeswalkers and we wanted them to match who they are, we needed to be very careful. So we have a big document now that's on our wiki that like, this is this planeswalker. And each planeswalker has something they do that no one else is allowed to do. And then they have things that they can do that can overlap. So the idea is each planeswalker has some identity that's uniquely their thing. So Jace is clearly taking one space up, but there's a lot of space in blue. I mean, we talk about this all the time, which is, what are other planeswalkers we can do? And there's a couple of different ways to approach it. We could come up with mechanically what can they do and then design from there. We come up with a cool flavor idea and design from there. And one of our favorites is coming up with cool superheroes we haven't done. You know, like, ooh, blue could be Iceman or something, you know. So.
Mark, I saw you at Jimmy John's yesterday.
I was at Jimmy John's yesterday.
What did you get?
Okay, the audience should know this because I eat the same thing for lunch every day. This wasn't on Jewish Rye, but it was ham and cheese. That is what I eat for lunch. So, I'm sorry, my blog knows that. You guys don't know that. On my blog, they get really into my minutia of things I do. So they have pictures of my toaster and anyway. Blogger Talk Live is on Monday. That's a different audience. We have a weird relationship, but it's...
My birthday is coming up.
Happy birthday.
Not me.
Okay.
Can you tell us some trivia on my favorite Zendikar card, Oracle of Moldiah?
Oracle of Moldiah. So this is one of the problems I have. I have a tradition I do on my blog where on their birthday, people can ask me trivia about the card they want to ask me trivia about. The assumption is I just have trivia on every card, and so they can ask me any card and I just know things, which isn't the case. So when people ask me things, the more broad they are, the better chance of me having something. Like Oracle of Moldiah, that's the one where your top of your card is face up, and if it's a land, you can play it?
Yes.
Okay. Once upon a time, I knew every card by name, and now there's 15,000 cards, so.
Well, let's try this.
Okay, so my memory of it is, we liked the card Future Sight, the one that Future Sight was named after, which allows you to play a card face up, and you can play off the top of your library. So we were in land world, we wanted to do land things, and I think that was just made as land Future Sight. That was the working concept, and
that's
a cool one, so.
Chandler's.
What?
That's Moldiah
Chandler's
card.
Okay, maybe I'm trying a different card. Anyway, there's some trivia. Happy birthday! Happy birthday!
What factors go into decisions to not meet players' expectations, such as damnation or fetch lands?
Okay, so I have said something publicly that I think has been a little bit misinterpreted. The role of the designer is to try to match expectations, meaning you want to make sure that what the audience expects and what you deliver matches up, meaning you don't want to say, hey, it's Battle for Zendikar, and you get there and it's all about, like, rabid squirrels. So maybe you guys are like rabid squirrels. But the idea is, oh, well, it's Battle for Zendikar. There better be Eldrazi and allies, and you know, we better have things you would expect on Zendikar. But what that doesn't mean is whatever people want is supposed to be there.
Right.
Because I know that I understand the audience wants things, but A, things you want don't necessarily make it good. I understand there's things you would like to see, but our goal is to make the best set we can, and what players want and what they will actually enjoy do not completely overlap. Also, we have a lot of consideration. Sometimes people want things that would be awesome, except we have this little thing called standard, and we can't put that card in the set that goes into standard. And so there's a lot of different factors. So the goal of a designer is to make sure that the expectations are met in a broad sense. But that doesn't mean if you come up with it, we have to do it. That's like the customer's always right. Well, I've said it, so I must be right. That's not quite how that's not what it means, actually. So we do try to meet expectations in the sense that we want to make sure we are doing things you like. We want the sets to be awesome. When you play Battle for Zendikar, it better feel like Battle for Zendikar. But that doesn't mean that every single thing you imagine in it necessarily will be in it. Hard truth.
This one's over my head.
Okay.
But
maybe I know
you'll probably get it.
Okay.
How soon can I expect a green coastal piracy?
Oh, okay. So coastal piracy is a blue enchantment, but all your creatures have the curiosity ability. Whenever they damage your opponent, you get to draw a card. The curiosity ability, codename, it's not really a made-up nickname, that ability is both in blue and green. So can green have an ability that can grant your creatures? Yes, it can. I think I've tried to make it multiple times. It hasn't seen print yet, but... it's a matter of time. It'll see print eventually.
Woo!
Woo! So, you heard it here.
So this one can be interpreted a couple of different ways. So we'll take it each way. Return to Sarpedia or return to Kamigawa.
Dun, dun, dun.
So I don't know if he's asking if we'll ever do either of those or if he's saying which of those is cooler.
Okay, this was my blog. This is how I interpret this question. There's a gun put to your head. You must do two things. Which would you do? And the answer
is... Does
it
even count as a return to Sarpedia? Have you ever really been there?
We were there once. It's Fallen Empires.
Oh, gotcha.
Okay. So the idea is return to the creative of Fallen Empires, return to the creative of Kamigawa. Neither of which are probably going to happen, but... Gun to head. Kamigawa would probably have a... We could salvage it better than Sarpedia, I think.
Yeah, I feel like we could do Kamigawa better than we did it.
Oh, for sure we can do Kamigawa better than we did it. Guarantee that, so.
Meanwhile, I just realized that I had that Sarpedia screwed up in my head with Segovia.
Oh, no. That's the land of the plane of little things.
Nerd problems.
So. Do you guys know the story? But real quick, the story of Segovia is very funny. So we made a card called Segovian Leviathan. And then in the art, they showed this Leviathan. But the art card was like a 3-3, I think. And so the creative team were like, wait, what? What? And so they came up with this whole story about how it's from the plain of Segovia. And in Segovia, it's a 3-3. And so it became this little, like, it became the land of little tiny creatures. So anyway, that... It was literally just creative going, okay, we messed that up.
Well, they continued on with the plane chase.
Well, I mean, once we committed to it, you know, might as well, once you're in, you're all in, so. Okay, next question.
Due to your hatred of bees, will they ever return to magic? Do you hate bees?
No. For the record, I hate hornets. So the problem with bees and hornets is they've been used for evil.
We're talking bees and hornets just on cards.
Yes, on cards.
Do you have
I don't hate sort of bees. Okay. Like the takeaway, Morrow hates bees. No. What happened was people had used them for evil purposes. I don't blame the bees or the hornets. There has been, Aaron Forsythe, probably the biggest culprit, by the way. Green is not supposed to do direct damage directly to creatures. And people keep going, but they're bees! And I'm like, that's not the reason to break the color by. One of the things that happens all the time is there's things that flavorfully make sense, but they don't mechanically make sense. And so the answer is, yes, that flavor makes sense, but just because we can do something doesn't mean we're supposed to always do it in monocolor. And so if we have a cool idea, maybe it's not a monocolor card. So the bees have become a thorn in my side only because... because it seems to be, like, whenever they... They know I don't like it, and so whenever Aaron and people try to push these cards through, they think it's funny, I guess, to make them hornets. So anyway, I'm being punked, basically. That's what hornets are. And I'm being punked in magic, so.
Is BFZ or Origins the start of a new age of design?
So I've talked about how there are 5 stages of design, and I keep saying at some point we'll have a 6th stage of design. I never really figured it out until after we're past it by a little bit. Like, it's not like one day I wake up and go, okay, new age of design. So I have to kind of look back with some retrospective. So the 6th age is starting somewhere around here, but I haven't quite, like, figured out exactly what that is. And so a lot of what's been going on is, as I sort of figure things out and write about it, eventually I will we're in the 6th age, I believe. I don't know quite where the dividing point is. But the way we design sets now is very different than what we did when I called the 5th age. So, like, we have shifted. There's a lot of, like, exploratory design has really, really changed how we do magic now. So the idea is we used to start design on a certain date, and now 6 months earlier we don't start design because we're not making cards, but we're sort of exploring different areas of, like, okay, we're going to go, it's Battle for Zendikar. What would you expect of Battle for Zendikar? And we explore a lot of sort of ideas. What I say is exploratory design is figuring out the questions you have to answer in design. And so a lot of it is just going down weird paths and trying to figure things out. And part of it is usually what happens is they'll make mechanics just so they can play test with me so we can get a feel of it. But it's not about the mechanics. And we go through like 40 mechanics or something. Kind of like Zendikar.
So I noticed that as we've been driving, you've stopped turning the wheel. Is that why we keep passing the same house?
I might be lost. I don't know. I predict in about 15 minutes I'm going to find wizards. Okay, next question.
I don't know exactly what this is all about.
Go ahead.
It just says Delver of Secrets?
Okay, so I don't know how many people who listen to my podcast follow my blog. I know there's obviously some overlap. So my blog has taken on a life of its own. There are certain topics that the blog feels very passionate about, one of which is Delver of Secrets. So here's that. Let me tell you the story of Delver of Secrets. So we wanted werewolves in Innistrad. So I said to my team, look, if we can make awesome werewolves, we can solve Innistrad. That's the goal. If we can make awesome werewolves, Innistrad will be a success. So Tom Lapilli, who had been working on a Duel Masters product, said, well, Duel Masters does this really cool thing where there's cards on both sides of the card. And I said, I don't know, but whatever. Okay, so I said, you're correct. I asked for things. We're not judging. So we had a day-night mechanic. We did double-face cards. So we did a whole bunch of stuff. And eventually, it became clear the double-face cards were awesome. And so I started looking for, I knew we were doing werewolves, but I wanted other tropes. And so it's like, okay, what are all the horror tropes where it's one thing that changes something else? And so one of the ideas, I wrote a whole bunch of ideas on paper. One of them was The Fly. So The Fly is a famous old horror movie with, I don't know, Vincent Price in it or something. But anyway, they redid it. Jeff Goldblum was in the new version. I think they've redid it again since then. So we wanted to do a fly. So The Fly was okay. On the front, it's got to be a scientist that's messing with things it's not supposed to. And then on the back, okay, it becomes some horrible insect-related thing because we're doing The Fly. And so on the front, I make it a wizard because wizard's the equivalent of a scientist in our world. And on the back, I made it like insect mutation, insect mutant. Now, I didn't actually think it would stay an insect necessarily, only because the creative, like I would go full tilt on whatever the thing I was doing, and creative would often tweak things a little bit. But no, they were all on board, and so it was a 1-1, and the idea was it turned into something. The version I turned over was a 2-2. Development actually turned it into, was it 3-2? Into a 3-2. Anyway, so it is a 1-mana 1/1, people. It is a 1-mana 1/1 that under the right condition can become a 3-2 flyer. But people have taken in their minds that it's a 3-2 flyer for one, and somehow that is a fundamental violation of what blue can do. And the answer I keep giving on my blog is creatures are so fundamental to the game, every color gets creatures. Blue might get less good creatures, but it doesn't get zero good creatures. It's allowed to have creatures. It's a 1-1 creature that in order to flip over, your deck has to be full of instants and sorceries, which is blue's shtick. So the idea is it's not just a mini creature that goes in an aggro blue deck. It's got to be in a spell-heavy blue deck. So I'm like, okay, this is why we made it. My blog will not accept this as a correct answer. And so here's how it works on the blog. I'll answer something about some innocent question, about something else, and then they reply with, yeah, what about Delver? And so it's become the return of Kamigawa and Delver Secrets seems to be the two things they will not let go of, like the little bone. If blood and tongue is a dog metaphorically, the bone they will not let go of is Delver Secrets and return to Kamigawa.
I guess that makes sense then.
So that's what they're asking, I think.
We've reached the final question.
The final question, okay.
What's a mechanic that you wanted to keep but got scrapped instead?
Oh, I have a lot of those. Okay.
Tell us the 38 Zendikar mechanic.
No, I didn't want to keep those. Okay, so here's the mechanic that I wanted to keep that I fought hard for and I lost. Is in Scars of Mirrodin, I wanted to bring back Affinity for Artifacts. And my argument was, we screwed up in the past. We're better now. We can make this work. And so I put it in the file. I talked to development, and I said, development, do you think you could do this? They said they thought they could. And then all hell broke loose. So the problem was, what people were worried about is, development occasionally will mess up, and something will slip through. The original Mirrodin was famous for having the largest exodus of players leaving the game. Because we had a very, very broken standard environment, for those that remember Mirrodin standard. And so the worry was, if we left it in and something happened, because development will miss on things, that this would be a really, really bad thing to miss on. And so they felt like development couldn't be aggressive on it. If they can't be aggressive on it, why make a mechanic that we can't really push, you know, for constructed? And so we ended up going with Meadowcraft. I I tried my hardest for it to be affinity for artifacts. I really did. I thought it'd be cool that we go back. Because what I wanted is, here's how badass the Phyrexians are. The Mirans have their best weapon, and they still lose. But, so the question was, different mechanics that I wanted?
That got scrapped.
Oh. So there was a mechanic in the original Mirrodin that I really, really, really liked that I... Bill Rose, I don't know, there was too much going on in it, and Bill wasn't super a fan of it at the time, and they removed it, and I begged, and I pleaded, and I couldn't save it. And it's a mechanic that I will find a home for, and it's one of the things that before I retire, this mechanic will be in a set. So, mystery mechanic will be in the set. You guys don't know what it is. Started in Mirrodin, we will find a home for it, and I'm confident we will find a home for it. It will happen.
I found a last question.
Okay.
The actual last question. He's pre-baked its own introduction.
Okay.
Hey, guys, it's that time again. It's time for birthday trivia.
Okay.
What has been your favorite podcast?
My favorite podcast? Ooh, that's a good question.
They didn't say of your own.
Of my own. Well, here's the problem. I don't have time to listen to podcasts because when I'm in my car... I'm either recording my podcast or listening to them to make sure I didn't say something I wasn't supposed to. So I don't unfortunately listen to a lot of other podcasts because I don't time. Of Drive to Work, that's hard. I
like that one that I was in.
What was your favorite of the ones you've done?
I don't know. They're all equally cool.
I have a couple highlights. I'm not going to pick one. But I did two, one with my mom and one with my dad. And that meant a lot to me. Both my parents growing up were very much inspiration to me. My dad was the gamer that taught me to game. My mom was a creative person that taught me to write. So, a lot of what I do came from both of them. But I'll tell you a behind-the-scenes story about my mom. My dad nailed it. It was great. So, my mom, before we drive, I'm laying out the rules for her. And I'm saying, here are the things you can't say. And she goes, okay, no problem. And then we finished. I got to where we're going. Because I think I'm driving to work and she's going to take my car. So I go, Mom, how many things do you think you said that I told you not to say? And she's like, I don't know, did I say something? 7, Mom. You said 7. So we didn't use that one. I had to drive for 3. My mom's the only time, actually, trivia, that I'm not driving to work. I'm taking her to the airport. So that's the one drive to work, and then I don't end up at work. I actually end up at the airport, although the airport's not super far from work. So I really enjoyed those. The current series that I'm really, really happy with is I'm doing 10 Things Every Game Needs. So the origin of that is my daughter was in 5th grade long ago. Her teacher said to us, hey, if you want to come talk to the class, I love having parents talk to the class. And so I said, oh, I'd love to. And I said, I'm a game designer. He goes, oh, I know, perfect. I have a whole thing on the American Revolution where the kids make a game. Why don't you come in and give them a 101 on game making? Well, I'd never done any 101 thing. So I made this little thing called 10 Things Every Game Needs. It was a half hour. And I spent time on it. So I had an article to write. I'm like, okay, I spent time on it. So I wrote it up as an article. It went over really well. So then I did a podcast on it, and that went over really well. So then I did a series on it. I'm up to, have you guys heard Fun yet? Has Fun been posted?
I think so.
Okay, I think Fun just got posted. So I have two more to record. I haven't actually recorded yet. I have two more to record. But I'm really, really happy. If you all like game design, it is so much game design packed in what's going to be 10 podcasts. It's kind of crazy. So if you really, it is not very magic-y as much as it's designery, but I'm real happy with that podcast. What are your favorite podcasts? I don't know. What are the classic Drive to Work podcasts? I don't even know. What?
Future Sight.
All of the cards. So here's a question. I've asked the audience a question. So I started changing to the point now where I go block by block. So when I do my design things, I go in order of the block. Is that preferable to the old one where I jumped around a lot?
Yes.
Okay. So how about this? You name a podcast, and I'll tell you a story about behind the scenes of that podcast. Name a Drive to Work podcast.
Walking the Plains is a good
one. Oh, Walking the Plains. I had to do that one twice because I did it, and then when I was listening it back, I realized I'd said 3 things incorrect. Because one of the things I'll do when I drive home is I record them on the way to work, and I listen to them right back, and I count up how many mistakes I made, and then my rule is when I get to 3, I'm like, oh, I got to redo it. If it's 1 or 2, a lot of times I'll say something like, right now I'm doing my Khan to Tarkir one, and on the 7th episode I say, this has been 8 episodes of Khan to Tarkir. And then I realize I'm listening, it's really good, okay, fine. So 1 or 2 mistakes it stays, but 3 mistakes I re-recorded.
You redo it all
The whole thing, the whole thing.
Have you considered, like, getting GarageBand? It's a computer program.
I literally don't have the time.
Yeah.
Like, when I say I edit on my drive to work, yeah. I have no time.
Yeah.
Like, that's, I literally be going, like, the next step is, when I sleep, can I tape my, am I doing something while I sleep that I can somewhat harness that for more social media stuff? So, I people keep saying, why do you edit? And I'm like, I just literally don't even have the time to edit. So, I do drive to work every day, so that,
yeah.
It's also, by the way, one of the cool things about re-recording is, I will make it better. So, the ones in which I actually have to do it multiple times, probably are better podcasts, because I've done them a bunch of times. But it makes me sad when I have podcasts where I did something really well, but I really messed something up badly. So, those make me sad. Okay, another drive to work. Another, name a favorite drive to work.
Number 27, bad cards.
Bad cards. So, I don't know if you guys Google my name, but one of the things going on right now is people use my bad card article and my podcast to argue about other games. And so my name pops up all the time. It has nothing to do with Magic. It's just people using my words on both sides of the argument to describe why they're correct. And so it is very entertaining to read. But the podcast, like, I can't get some people to understand. Like, one of the things about the bad cards thing is this idea that, like, all the cards can't be good. They just can't all be good. Like, there's people that just, in their heart, don't believe that to be true. And I'm like, we can make really, really small sets, maybe make that true. But, you know, something's going to be good. And that Ancestral Recall is good until you make draw four. Then it's not that good. And power is relative. So, anyway, I think we have 1 or 2 minutes left. Any other drive to work here? You want to know about behind the scenes?
Is there any chance of you doing, like, a series on the three colors? On, like, three color?
That is a very popular question. So I just finished my two-color series. A lot of people are asking about three-color. Maybe. Here's the tricky thing about three-color is the philosophy for three-color is a lot muddier than the philosophy for two-color. Like, it's not quite as clean. And so depending on how you sort of angle, I mean, I might do it. People are asking for it. And then people want the 4-color one, and when you can do the 5-color one. So, one of the things about the podcast when I first started it was I was worried that I would run out of material, and now I'm like 260 podcasts in, and I'm like, oh, there's a lot to talk about in Magic. So, but I'm looking for a new series.
There's The Office.
There's The Office.
Coming into view. In
the oh, there's The Office. Okay. I knew it was by the house. Okay, so. Now we got a pull in our face. So, I guess thank you for joining me, Matt, for our first ever live to work.
It's good.
And
fun times.
We've now parked in the parking space. Can you do my end?
I don't think so.
I parked my space. So we all know what that means. It means it's the end of my drive to work. So instead of talking magic, it's time for me to be making magic. See you next time.
Donut.
Thank you guys for coming. This is a first, a non-moving vehicle podcast, so I heard they were possible. So thank you guys. Now I gotta eat my donut.